a busy few weeks prepping all this material with my colleagues, and it's been such a pleasure working with all of them. I just want to thank Taylor Lentz, Petra Alec, and Felix Koh for all their help. So how this is going to go, the purpose of the recital is to showcase the marimba through a combination of performance and informal discussion. Because the marimba is a relatively new instrument in the Western world, with its first ancestors dating back to the 1930s, it has a very limited repertoire compared to older instruments such as violin, cello, and the lute, just as examples. Specifically, the marimba lacks original works in courtly dances and suites that were composed during the time of J.S. Bach. To highlight the musicality and unique sound of the marimba, percussionists often utilize Bach's work. However, the instrument is not a substitute for the original instruments. And this recital aims to give, to kind of guide you through my personal thought process when looking at a work by Bach. To provide a well-rounded program, I've chosen two contemporary works to precede and then follow my Bach selections. These works will demonstrate various ways in which the marimba is used in the contemporary repertoire, showcasing its versatility and potential as a modern instrument. Hopefully you'll be able to see the range of possibilities that the marimba has to offer through this recital. So first, Anderson's composition, The Loneliness of Santa Claus, defied the prevailing perception at his time that percussion instruments were primarily used to produce louder and faster music. Instead, Anderson approached the marimba in a unique way, using it to create soundscapes that featured extreme lows, slow tempos, pointillistic and open textures, and unusual chord spacing. This approach produced a gentle, lush, and contemplative work that showcased the marimba's full potential as a versatile and expressive instrument. One of the marimba's unique features is its wide dynamic range and rich resonance. While it can produce a powerful and robust sound, it's the softer dynamics that really showcase the instrument's magic. In a hall like this one, the marimba's tone is beautifully projected at low volumes, producing a captivating effect. Despite the instrument's inability to sustain notes by itself for long periods of time, it still manages to sing with its limited but beautiful resonance. Percussionists can use this quality to their advantage, connecting lines or disconnecting notes to create distinct musical events. Anderson skillfully exploits this characteristic of the marimba in The Loneliness of Santa Claus, leveraging its unique resonance to create a contemplative and introspective soundscape. Anderson's approach to the marimba's resonance involves a combination of slow tempi and sparse pointillistic textures. By using sparser textures, the subtleties of the instrument's resonance becomes more apparent, such as the subtle differences in sound produced by striking the instrument with different parts of the mallet, such as the core of the mallet, this portion, or the head of the mallet, this portion. While the marimba sounds beautiful in the denser textures, as you will hear later, it can be challenging to discern these important nuances. Furthermore, Anderson's use of slower tempi and longer note durations helps to create more open and less busy textures, as well as soft undertones of harmony. In terms of harmony and chords, Anderson employs wide interval chords, which contribute to the open texture of the piece and highlight the interplay of the overtones of the notes. Notes that are more closely spaced together or spaced have less opportunity for the overtones to interact with each other with the fundamentals, whereas wider intervals can be used to amplify and even diminish the resonance of the notes in different ways. Lastly, I want to mention Anderson's use of unconventional sounds / ascended techniques. While this is not unique to the marimba, it benefits from its large size and the various other parts, which allows for a wide range of unconventional sounds beyond the standard use of mallets. In the piece, I use my knuckles at one point on the bars to create a ticking clock effect, showcasing just one of the many unconventional sound possibilities. Despite the vast potential, Anderson only explores just a fraction of these possibilities. So now, please welcome Taylor Lentz to the stage, who will present the Loneliness of Santa Claus. talk about the next gigs. I also just want to thank my colleagues for helping with instrument setups while I have my little talk. Thank you guys again. All right, so now that we've heard the marimba in one type of sonic world, let's explore a different era where the marimba did not exist, the later Baroque era of J.S. Bach. The marimba doesn't have any repertoire from this purely tonal and courtly dance era, so we have to look back at Bach's work for other instruments. One piece that the marimba can handle in this world is his lute suite in E minor, BWV 996, composed for lute. While performing this piece on the marimba, we face the question of whether to emulate the lute and remain grounded in the practices of the time, or to utilize the vastly differing color palette of the marimba and create something new. Personally, I aim to strike a balance between the two approaches. I try to perform the work in a manner that highlights the harmonic structure and ornamentations of the times, while also embracing the unique qualities of the marimba to create something distinct. First, as I said before, the marimba doesn't resonate for a long period of time. Well, guess what? So does lute. So marimba can do a pretty good job at maintaining the note durations that are written in the lute part without having to add in any extraneous rolls. Additionally, the lute players would play with their fingers, so they could have up to five fingers playing at their disposal at the same time. Well, luckily for us, we can use four mallets. If the chords have more than four notes, we might have to roll the notes so that they can all be played, but for the most part, we can play the notes pretty true to the score. That is where my emulation of the lute ends, though, as I'm also an advocate for trying to bring more of my instrument and its color palette to the forefront of a performance of Bach's music rather than purely emulating the instrument. The biggest way that I utilize the tone and resonance of this instrument is through my mallet choices. It's challenging to change the color of the notes when playing on the lute as you're plucking the strings. Not much you can really do there. There are many ways that we can change the color on the marimba. From movement to movement, I will change mallets in order to better take advantage of and enhance the instrument's resonance. As an example, during the Allemande, I'm going to use somewhat of a medium hard mallets for the upper three and a medium soft for my bass note, so that I can take advantage of their hardness, so that there's enough clarity for moving lines, but I can also take advantage of brief moments of gentler playing through techniques like slightly playing more on the top of the mallet, like I discussed earlier. Moving to the sarabande, I would choose some medium soft mallets for the top three and a soft bass mallet at the very bottom, so that I can get more of the resonance out of the instrument. This movement is slower and slightly more expansive, so maximum resonance is needed for connecting note to note. Finally, for the beret and the gigue, I utilize hard mallets and a medium hard bass mallet, as these movements have quite a bunch of activity that clarity is a paramount concern. Of them all, the mallets for the bore and the gigue would actually most closely emulate the sound of the lute, as they have a very clear attack at the front of their sound than the others. Having the different mallets for the Allemande and sarabande, however, creates a new type of movement-based sound quality that you could never really get from the lute itself. I aim to bring out the unique color palette of the marimba in my performances of Bach's music as well, rather than simply emulating instruments. One way I do this is through the other method I use, albeit less often in this work, is where we play on the bars. You heard a fine example of this during the Anderson. At one point, the composer specifically wanted myself to play over top of where the cord that holds the bars in the marimba passes through them. We add the play directly on top. What this does is it takes away the full tone of the bar and leaves a very thin and hollow sound. Well, for Bach, I would never go quite that far so that all tone is removed. But sometimes when you need a more transparent sound, move a little closer towards that node away from the center. That way it takes out a little bit of the resonance. Okay, that's enough of information for the Bach. Now let's actually hear it. Please enjoy. Thank you. Okay, so before we go on, I need to take a moment, to recognize someone. Teaching students can be a very challenging thing, especially trying to inspire them to be creative or to simply put in the extra work needed to learn an instrument. My journey through percussion has been quite a roller coaster.
Right.
But I know that I wouldn't be where I am if it wasn't for my teachers, and especially my first teacher. I'm very fortunate to have that teacher, my middle school band director, here today. I cannot overstate how vital he was to my personal growth. And he truly went above and beyond to help me grow. He was actually the first person to teach me how to play using formal technique. And he's a trumpet player. Not only that, but him helping me work on it twice, if not three times a week after school, that is truly beyond the description of a band director. I have so much of an appreciation for how much of his time and energy that he gave to me, especially now having taught music to students myself. I truly would not be here right now in front of you today if it was not for this. So, Mr. Good, thank you for every minute you spent with me, for pushing me to be the best I could be, and for believing me. You really are one of the best and most inspiring teachers I have ever met. Thank you. Okay, so now it's time to conclude the program. We're going to conclude this program with a contemporary piece. Mouth Quartet by Steve Reich takes a different approach to the marimba, utilizing it as a background harmonic and rhythmic support for the melody and canons present in the vibraphones. Reich was very particular about the mallets that he wanted to use, even specifying the model. He had chosen rubber mallets to create a consistently bright sound on the marimba throughout the three movements. And throughout those three movements, they remain minimal. In contrast to Anderson's piece, which explores a diverse range of sounds and colors, Reich's marimbas maintain an overall consistent sound throughout the whole piece. In regards to the marimba, that's pretty much all I have to say in regards to the Reich. After recital, on music stand where you got your programs, there's a piece of paper. I would like to send you a survey with a few questions about your experience. So if you'd be willing to put down your name and email, I greatly appreciate the opportunity to get your feedback. Thank you all so much for coming. Please welcome Taylor, Petra, and Felix to perform Steve Reich's Mouth Quartet. Thank you.
Thank you.
freezing, man.
Oh, hey, food.
I guess it's a Marimba thing.